SQL programming language. As you all are aware, SQL is a non-procedural programming language and it doesn't have the programming capability. So what Oracle did in 1980s that it developed a programming language called PLSQL. PLSQL stands for Programming Language SQL. So this was done to provide the capability to process the data line by line, wherein the SQL queries cannot do it. So we will look at what are the features of PLSQL. And we'll also look at what are the advantages of using PLSQL. The first feature of PLSQL is that it is tightly integrated with SQL. It means you can embed the programming language statements inside SQL, or SQL can be embedded into the programming language statements. Second, it provides a large set of data types. So we have a variety of data types which are compatible with the Oracle database, and you can use in a wide range of applications. So the rich set of data types help you to program, write the programs in a very easy way. We shall look at a few other features. Third is extensive error checking. So as you all know, when you are processing data, exceptions could occur or runtime error could occur. So there is a well-defined mechanism whereby you can do the error checking in a very extensive way, in a very structured way. Last one, it supports structured programming. Right? You can organize your code in a very well-defined way using functions and procedures. So PLSQL has these important features, and because of which it's very, very popular. We shall now look at what are the advantages of using PLSQL. what are the advantages of using VLSQL? See, when you use SQL, you are going to send one line of SQL statement at a time to the Oracle server for processing. If you use VLSQL, since it is block structured programming language, you can send a block of SQL statements at once to the server for processing, because of which the network traffic will be reduced. So it's a more efficient way of sending the code for processing because of the nature of SQL, VLSQL. The second is it is highly productive. From the programmer point of view, this VLSQL is highly productive. That is because you can query, transform, and modify all at once. So VLSQL allows you to query the database, change the contents of the database and update it. So all three can be done in one go, and that's why it is very, very efficient or productive from programmer's perspective. The next set of advantages are VLSQL is highly portable. That is, the VLSQL programs that you write on Windows platform can easily be run on a Linux platform or a Macintosh platform. However, you need to have Oracle running on Linux or running on Mac operating system. So because it is highly portable, you don't need to make any changes that you have written in Windows to make it run on Linux platform. So portability is a very, very important advantage of using VLSQL. The fourth one is the fourth advantage is predefined set of functions. These are called as packages. So VLSQL comes with a rich set of packages using which you can reduce the application development time, because most of the functionality that you need is already present in these packages. For example, you want to find the average of a set of values. So there is a package, and within that package there are functions to find the average without you having to write the code to perform this mathematical operation. So there is a wide set of packages available, wide range of packages available, using which you can do a lot of processing without you having to write all the code all by yourself. So the last one is it supports object-oriented programming. And web app development. As you all know, object-oriented programming language has certain advantages, and you can leverage the advantage of the concepts in object-oriented programming for writing your VLSQL code. Apart from this, you can also develop web applications directly into VLSQL and make your data visible on the websites directly. So these are the features and advantages of ELSQL. Having learned the introductory part of ELSQL, we shall now get into the details of what this programming language is and what are the program constructs, data types, and the features that are available for you to write the code. So, as I told you, ELSQL is block structured programming language. Now, what is this block structured programming language? All code that you write has to be written inside a block defined using two keywords, begin and end. And there is a separate section for you to declare the variables. So let me show you the structure of a typical ELSQL program. It begins with the declare section. Then this is the block, beginning of the block, and you will have the end of the block. And within the begin end block, you can have again some more begin end blocks, and you can have a section called as exception. This is optional. Exception is optional, but wherever you need, you can have a exception section within the begin end block. So your entire code will be written using these important keywords: declare, begin, exception, and end. So let me show you how we can write a simple program to demonstrate the structure of a ELSQL program. So it's customary to write a hello world program, as you all do in a beginning of learning any programming language. So let me show you how to write a hello world program using ELSQL. So we have begin section. We have declare section, where I declare a variable, then I have a begin section, and then I have a end section. So let me not have the exception part. So if you want to declare a variable, it has to be done within the declaration section. So let me declare a string. Let us call it as greeting, which is of type varchar2. Let us say the length is 20. And you can right away initialize this here. Observe, the name of the variable comes first, then the data type, followed by colon equal to, and we can assign a constant string, let us say hello world. So the declaration and initialization can both be done within the declaration section, or you can only declare here and initialize here. Both ways is possible. So let's do it this way, where I have declared a variable called as greetings, which is a string constant. It's a variable which can hold a string constant hello world. And within the begin end block, I want to make use of this greetings to display on the screen. So to display some data on the screen, there is a package called as dbms output. This is the package which is inbuilt. You don't have to import or anything. You can directly use like this. And then the method is putLine. It's not printLine, it is putLine. And then you can give greetings. Now, no single quotes here. If you want to append greetings, something else, you can put a operator to do that, but let's not do it. So this is the simplest hello world program. Once you type it in SQL prompt, you have to type this in SQL prompt and press forward slash. So the program runs, and what you get on the output is hello world. So this is the output that you get when you execute this program. So executing a program is simply go on typing this in SQL form, and when you are done, put a forward slash and you get the program executed. Observe that the begin end has a semicolon here, and all statements should have a semicolon at the end. So that must be kept in mind while you write the SQL programs. So let us now do little more, where we'll declare data of different types. For example, int, float, double precision, and all, and then see how we can write a program. So let's say we want to write a program where a is integer type, which is assigned 5. B is also integer type, assigned with 7 value, and C is another variable which we want to use in our program. Begin. So let's do simple multiplication and display the result. You say C equals A star B, and you can say DBMS output dot put line result of A star B equals C. So just observe what I have done. I have declared two variables of integer type. The third variable is the integer again to hold the result of multiplying A and B. And I am printing the result as result of A and A star B equal to C. Observe this concatenation operator, two vertical lines, to concatenate string with integer, and the output will be result of A star B equal to 35. So that you can get in the output. You can declare variables of other types also. So let me show you how to declare variables of other types. So let me show you C float colon equal to 7.59. D float equals 2.35, and E float. So you can perform E equals C by D, and you can print DBMS output dot put line result of C by D equals C. So this will do the division of two real numbers, and the output is put like this. Okay. So let us see how we can write a meaningful program. Finding area of a circle, as you all know. So to find area of a circle, you require radius. Then we require another variable area. Then we require a constant pi. So the way to declare pi is, we have to declare rad float semicolon area float, and pi, you have to use the keyword constant, and you can use double precision. Remember, this is a data type. Double precision is a data type, and you can assign 3.142. Okay. Now you can initialize radius within this block, let us say 7.95, and you can calculate the area as pi star rad star rad. So as you can see, you can do the required calculations and print the result dot put line area of circle equal to is a simple program wherein you declare variable of appropriate type, define a constant also, initialize, do the calculations and then print the program. So far we have seen the structure of a VLSL program, which is block structure. Now there are a large number of data types which are available in PLSQL. I am not going to go into the details of all the data types, but you should be aware of few of them. So data types in PLSQL. So the fundamental data types are called as scalar data types. So all these include your int, small int, float, double precision, then you have number, how many digits you want to have, then numeric, this is scale and precision, then you have number, numeric, decimal, so scale and precision. Now apart from these, of course we have okay, so these are for character arrays and these are fixed type and variable length. Okay, then apart from these we have blobs, binary large objects to hold images, text, etc. So we have glob. Okay. B file, binary file. Okay. So this is for binary large objects. If you want to store an image, you can do that. This is for holding a large text file, and this is for holding a large binary file. Okay. So these are the various data types which are available in PLSQL. So you should be aware of data types and to declare variables of appropriate type depending on the type of application you are developing. Okay. All right. So as with any programming languages, we have control statements and loops. So let's see what are the control structures in PLSQL. Okay. So the program flow can be regulated by using the control statement. So we have if then, this is first one. Second is if then else and if, this is if then and if then else and if, third one and the last so this is like a switch statement. Okay, So you have if then and if then else and if then else if and then a large number of if then else conditions, then we have a case variable. So let's quickly look at some examples to illustrate the use of these control statements. So if you want to check whether something is bigger than another, so begin, declare A int equal to 5, B int equal to 7, then begin if A greater than B, then DBMS output dot put line A greater than B and if. So you can do only so much. Check whether A greater than B. If you wanted to print B greater than A, then you could use else here instead of terminating with and if. So the way to do that is simply here you put else. DBM then so don't forget to end this begin end and there should be ending for every if statement. Okay, so now we know how to use the if statements. If then else is same. Okay, then I don't need to go into the details of how we can use this, but we can look at how we can use so let's declare score as char. And score if it is equal to A or B or E, then we can check whether depending on the score you can declare, you can use case score when A B when A then okay, then you can write case you can the score B, etc. Okay. And when you want to terminate, you should have it's important case, end case, and then end. So the control statements are if then else, then case then. So please remember. So in the exam you get a question, write a program to demonstrate the control statements if then else, if then else if and also case when. So you should be able to write the programs to demonstrate the use of control statements. Now when it comes to looping, there are three types of loops. One is basic loop, that is loop and loop. So no checking is done, you just enter the loop and within the loop you use a if statement and use exit to exit the loop.
Second is while loop. So the way to do this is while. Condition, then loop,
sorry, this is while,
there is no then here, while condition loop and loop.
So you can use while loop to do this. And the third looping structure is for loop. Okay, so there are three loops here: basic loop, that is loop and loop. Second is while loop. The third one is for loop. So let's quickly look at examples for this.
So this is begin and let us say a equal to 5, b equal to 6. So why you can say loop and just say a equals a plus b if a greater than 25 exit okay then end loop. End.
So this is an example for basic loop. Of course, we should have declared a and b here. So we'll have declare a int comma b int. So this is the complete program for performing the looping. Okay. So let's now look at while loop.
So same program.
We'll look at while loop. So let's say a and b, a assigned to 10. Then you can put a while loop here. While a less than 50, loop. Then within this a equals a plus 10 and loop. So the loop starts here checking the condition a less than 10. It will do addition of 10, again loop back until a crosses 50. So you will come out and you can print a equals whatever is the value of a. Okay, observe that this a equal to is a string. To that the actual a value is concatenated. So if you look at this, the value of a will be 50, okay, at the end of the loop, and it will print 50 here. Okay, now let's look at how we can do for loop. So for loop we are going to use a counter variable. Let's take I int. Okay, the way to do this is for I in, you have to give a range 10 to 100 loop. Okay, so it will start with I equal to 10, then 11, 12, up to 100 it will go. Or if you want a smaller count, let it be 20. Observe dot dot here. So from 10 to 20, it will loop every time incrementing the value of I by 1. Okay. And then if you want to declare another variable sum, okay, you can initialize sum to 0. Sum equals sum plus I. Okay, and then end loop. Okay.
Okay, so this will loop until I reaches 20, and the result will be in the this thing. So DBMS put line sum equals sum. Okay, then end. So you can use for loop like this, and you can go from this range, right? If you reverse the range 20 to 10, it will decrement. Okay, so there is no increment or decrement operator. Automatically it will take care of the loop while using it in the program. Okay, so we have looked at so just to summarize at this point in time, we looked at PLSQL features and advantages. That is, it supports many data types, it is efficient, it is portable, etc. Then second, we looked at variables, data types, constant declaration, etc. So we looked at various data types like int, float, char, numeric, okay, decimal, etc. And we also saw how to define a constant. Then we looked at control statements, if then case. Again, in if you have many different types, if then and if then else and if, and then if then else and so on. And then we have case statement, case when. So here case when, right? This is like your switch statement in C programming language. Then we looked at looping. So we have while and for loops. So we saw the basic loop wherein there is no condition check, just loop without a condition check. Within the body of the loop, we have to check the condition for termination. Then we have while loop, and then we saw how to write a for loop. So this is a summary of what all we have done so far. So let's now move on to the more interesting stuff. That is, we saw that PLSQL is a structured programming language, and for make it a structured programming language, it should have support for functions and procedures. So writing the function, you are all aware that you should have a appropriate name of the function. You should indicate what type of data it returns and what type of arguments and the types it accepts. So a block of code can be designated with a name, and that entire block of code can be called with the name of the block, and that is called a function, right? So PLSQL supports functions and procedures. A function has to return a value, so it will, in the declaration it will always have a return statement, whereas a procedure or a sub program will not have a return statements in its declaration. Okay, and when you pass arguments, the arguments can be of any type that are available in PLSQL, and also they have to be indicated whether it is a in variable, out variable, or a in out variable. In variable means the value can only go from calling function to the called function. Out means the value can go only from function to the called function. In out means it can either act as an in variable or an out variable. Okay, so let's look at how to create a function. So the syntax is create or replace. Remember, when you create a function, it is already stored on the disk with a name. So if you have an existing name, it will be replaced if you put replace here. So you can create a new one or replace it with an appropriate name. Then you should use the keyword function. Okay, and then you define
the name of a function. Let's have Maxwell. So this is the name of the function which I am going to declare. This is going to accept two values, a which is the in variable and of type int. Similarly, b is a in variable of type int, and c is an out variable, or you don't require an out variable here, and its return type is int. Okay, so this is how we declare a function, and you must use the keyword either is or as. So I'm using as. I'm declaring the function maxval as the following. You can have begin statement here, and before begin you can declare a variable. So let's say c is of type int. Okay, so what we can do is, if a greater than b, then c equals a, else c equals b, and simply say return c, and you have an end block. Okay, so create replace function, name of the function, variable list with appropriate type, and indicate whether it's a in type or out type, and what is the return value. It's an integer type, so I take a integer variable and I can return. There is no need for taking variable c. I could have said if a greater than b, then simply return a, else return b. I could have done this, but just to be clear with you that a local variable declared here can be returned as the result. Okay, now how to call this function. So I can write this function before your declare section. Okay, max int a int or x equal to 5, y int colon equal to 7. Okay, then begin. So within the body of the function you can call the function. So you can say max equals maxval x comma y. So this is how you invoke the function. So whenever program is run, this will transfer control here, it will execute this code and comes back with the result, and you can display the result with the package DBMS output. Okay, so this is how you can write a program. So in the exam you could get a question, what are functions, give the general declaration of a function, and write a function called maxval or minval to demonstrate how a function is written in PLSQL. So you could give this example itself. So another example is, could be write a function to find area of circle given radius. So you can practice writing this program. Second one could be find the net salary given basic DA, HRA, CCA and income tax. So you can write a function to do this, and the function should return the net salary of an employee. Okay, so you try writing these two programs. So from the exam point of view, these two are very important. Okay, so let's now look at how to write a procedure.
As I told you, procedure will not have a return data type. So the way to do this is simply procedure. Okay, create or replace. Okay, so we will take a specific example to demonstrate this. Let us say we want to find again the maximum of two values. Find max val. Okay, now the inputs are a in int, b in int. Okay, now since procedure cannot return a value, there should be a variable called c which is of type out. So you say c out int. There is no return type, there is no say return, but you can use the keyword as. Okay, now again you can have begin end of the procedure. Now all that you have to do is if a greater than b, then c equals a, else c equals b. That's all. So automatically the variable c will get the value, and there's no return statement here. Okay, now how do I call this function or this procedure? So you have begin and you have declare also. You can have x int equals 5, y int equals 9, then we can have z int. Okay, and within the body of the function you can call as maxval x, y, comma z. So z will contain the maximum value. Simply have to say dbms output put line max equals z. That's all. Okay, so there is no return value here, so there is no equal to sign, unlike the function. So procedure is very simple. You just have to write a procedure with certain set of arguments. Any value want to return from the procedure, it has to be of type out. A procedure need not return a value. In that case, you do the processing and print the result here itself and simply invoke it from the main block. Okay, so what we have looked at today is how to write a function and a procedure. All right, so whatever has been given in your syllabus is completed now. But just for the sake of completion, let us look at what exceptions are. These are called as runtime errors. So as I told you, PLSQL provides you a well-defined structure to catch the errors. Right? Strict error checking is done before the program executes, so we have a mechanism to do that. Now how do I define an exception and raise an exception? So let's take an example. You declare a variable, let's call as balance float colon equal to 3000. Okay, then you declare an exception, you have to raise that exception. So you can define an exception here, not enough balance exception. Okay, then you begin your block. you do some processing, for example, balance equals balance minus 4000. Okay, balance equal to, so if balance less than 1000, then raise not enough balance, and if okay, now we'll continue this here. So as I told you, there is a exception block before the end. So end is here, this is your end. Within the exception block, you have to catch the exception, right? So the way to catch is when not enough balance, then okay. So you say DBMS output dot put line not enough balance or transaction failed. Okay, then you have end. So you can define any number of exceptions here, and while doing the computations, you can raise those exceptions and catch them here so that your runtime errors are taken care of. Okay, so the programs will not abruptly crash if you have the mechanism to handle the errors at runtime. Okay, so we have come to the end of this session on PL SQL. So we have come to the end of this session on PL SQL. I'm sure all of you have understood the concepts of writing programs in PL SQL. So the key things to remember are what PL SQL is, what are its features, what are its characteristics, what are the different data types that are declared are available in PL SQL, how to declare them, how to initialize them, how to write a block structure code by declaring the section, declaration section, begin end, and how to use the various control statements like if then else, then you have case when, okay, and then the loops, the for loop, the while loop, the loop, the basic loop, okay. And you should be very good at writing your own functions in PL SQL. This is very important from the industry perspective. So when you go to industry to develop some meaningful applications, you will end up writing a lot of PL SQL code. So you should be good at writing functions and also the procedures. Okay. Of course, we could not cover the object-oriented aspect of PL SQL, which is beyond the scope of your syllabus. But you should know how to. You can refer to any tutorial on the net to know more about object-oriented feature of PL SQL. We also looked at how to declare exceptions, how to raise exceptions, and how to handle them. Okay. So with this, I conclude my lecture here. I'm sure you all enjoyed going through the lecture, and I'm sure you'll be able to face the exam with a lot of confidence with this lecture. Okay. Thank you so much. Thank you very much.